Hi, everyone, and welcome to On the Fly. I'm Jamie Hirsch, and Mike Johnson will join us here shortly. Five games across the NHL on Sunday, and while Edmonton-Pittsburgh wasn't maybe the juiciest matchup of the day, it is always must-see TV when Connor McDavid and Sidney Crosby go head-to-head. For almost his entire career, Crosby was viewed as the absolute best player in the world, and it's only been a handful of years since Connor McDavid has now taken over that title. But McDavid is truly on another level, again. And at 27 years old, he's notched his seventh 100-point season, which is already more than Crosby has. Their teams are headed in opposite directions right now, and that trend continued in a big way on Sunday.
Here in Pittsburgh, Edmonton Oilers come in with the second most wins in the league since Chris Knobloch took over, Eddie, led by the superstar combination of McDavid and Draisaitl.
Matias Ekholm, a flick of the wrist, put it back in the Pittsburgh zone. A turnover by Letang. Wrist shot score. Connor McDavid. He needed a minute eight to answer. And it's 1-0 Edmonton on McDavid's 24th.
Well, the primary assist goes to Chris Letang. Puts it right on the tape of Connor McDavid.
McDavid. Bouchard. Ekholm, a one-timer score. 2-0 Edmonton.
Yeah, great one-timer here by Ekholm. A good transitional play by Edmonton. There was a turnover inside the zone. You wonder, how does a puck go by a goaltender from that far? He didn't see it for a brief moment.
Here's Perry. Up behind the Penguins net. Out for Nurse, a shot of that glove by Jari.
Oh, nice play there by Perry. Excellent play by Nurse to find that soft little spot. And Tristan Jari again. A nice save.
Here's Evander Kane. Looks to get past Patterson. Oh, good. That's the shot away.
Save.
Bemstrom against CeCe won that race. Eller, Bemstrom, back to Eller. They slid it wide. CeCe had a perch. They tied up.
That was close.
But you know what I'm saying, Louie? It feels like Edmonton has this one under wraps, but the scoreboard says no. Now we got another penalty. Fogel will be heading to the box, and now Fogel's going to have to fight. Ludwig is not giving him a choice. He's landing a couple of left hooks, and the two collapse onto the ice.
This is going to even this out.
Yes.
Edmonton leading 2-0. Both goals in the first period. McDavid and Ekholm. Pass from McLeod, broken up by Pettersson, covered by Jari. McDavid with Ethan Hopkins and Hyman for the Oilers. Here's Carlson with the pass ahead for Rust. Slams into Pickard, and a penalty will be assessed.
See if he gets pushed in or not.
No, not at all.
You got to try and avoid the goalie there at all costs, and Russ not able to do it.
That's all for
and
Calvin Pickard.
He's been called out.
I got to think he'll be back in short order. He doesn't seem like there's any type of ill effects for him.
Anytime it's the head, you want to make sure you're okay. And Stuart Skinner will step in there with a minute 16.
Cal Pickard has returned. Stuart Skinner came on for the final minute 16.
Ludwig, who served that 10-minute misconduct for instigation, now defending McDavid to Nurse, shoots and scores! 3-0 Edmonton! Nurse, his seventh, set up by McDavid, who's had a three-point afternoon.
Well, Pickard has done his job here this afternoon, too. I mean, I know a lot of talk about Edmonton maybe needing a backup goaltender, but they're like this. That's some solid goaltending that Pickard has provided this afternoon.
Briggs had a chance to clear and failed to get it done. Ekholm. Nurse, shot, score! Darnell Nurse with his second goal of the third period.
Looks up and he sees Corey Perry right in front of Tristan Jari. The perfect opportunity to let that shot go. And you can see by the reaction of Jari, it's in the net before he even recognizes where it was.
Stuart Skinner on the bench to the left of me, I mean, banging his blocker on the boards for his partner.
They are named Crosby going at it.
Now Bunting comes in.
Well, Crosby got a piece of Desharnais, and he didn't like it. And now Letang is right in the middle of it. The puck went into the right-wing corner, and then Crosby made contact, and him and Desharnais were battling.
Well, the Edmonton Oilers come into Pittsburgh and shut out the Penguins 4-0.
It's the first shared shutout since January 1985 against the Quebec Nordiques.
For whatever reason, like you have your favorite buildings and not so much around the league, but I love this building. It's bright. It's always good energy, and you know, I fared well here before, so I was excited to get to start today.
You know, as a Lear guy, it's been around for a while. You want to come out in an effort like this and make an impact, and you know, this was a good night where I was able to capitalize on a couple chances, and hopefully that can continue and continue to build as the end of the year comes.
So, brilliant performance for the Oilers, right? But get this. With Stuart Skinner replacing Calvin Pickard briefly, very briefly, during Sunday's game, it ended up being the Oilers' second combined shutout in team history. The only other time this happened was way back in 1985 when Andy Moog and Grant Fuhr shared a shutout. Oh, and Sunday was also the first time Edmonton ever shut out Pittsburgh in a game. Mike Johnson here to break it all down for us. And again, really quality effort for Edmonton. But you got a feel for Calvin Pickard a little bit, right? It cost him a shutout because he left for a bit.
Yeah, so it's interesting, the rules that if you leave the game, you don't play the entirety of the game as the goaltender. You don't get credit individually for the shutout. And he was pulled for 76 seconds at the end of the second period. Because of concussion protocol, he got knocked over and he stayed in his net for a little bit. And so they pulled him out. But that doesn't diminish how well he played in this game. Yes, it was a very comfortable Edmonton Oilers win and they showed a lot of good things. But a lot of the conversation around the trade deadline was, should Edmonton go out and get somebody else to support Stuart Skinner? Mm-hmm. Should Marc-Andre Fleury? Should some other, should James Reimer, somebody, yeah. Nedeljkovic, whoever it might be. And Calvin Pickard's just saying, hang on. Hang on. I don't need any support. Every time he goes in there, you look at his win-loss records, very strong for a backup, for even for a starter. So he's playing well enough, and he's going to have to play well to make sure Stuart Skinner gets enough rest in preparation for the playoffs. But a really strong effort by him, answering any critics that may have thought they needed an upgrade in the backup position.
Yeah, absolutely. And the team in front of him played very well indeed. And it wasn't just Darnell Nurse and company being solid stay-at-home defensemen. No, they weren't stay-at-home defensemen. They were actively involved in this game. How did that impact it?
Well, so the Edmonton Oilers get a lot of goals from the defense. One defenseman, Evan Bouchard, scores a lot. Mm-hmm. The Bouch bomb, he's got a great shot. He scores an awful lot on the power play. But they haven't been getting sort of other defenders scoring like an Ekholm, like a Nurse. They're both on very lengthy, over a month-long goal-scoring droughts for two guys who are supposed to chip in, you know, 7, 8, 9, 10 goals over the course of a season. And with the amount of speed that the Edmonton Oilers can play with off the rush, the second layer of offense should be more available. And that means getting up in the play like you saw Darnell Nurse get there and picking up some points, picking up some goals. And the very best teams have good production from the blue line. So the fact that Ekholm and Nurse combined for a couple goals, and Bouchard even wasn't even one of them that scored a goal for the Oilers. It's good news because they need more of that down the stretch and on into the playoffs. So always good to bump a slump, even if you're a defenseman.
And look at the number of games played by all these. I mean, when we're talking injuries throughout the league,
right?
Edmonton's been remarkably healthy on the blue line, and maybe that's starting to show in terms of the consistency we're seeing.
Yeah, listen, it's a real luxury that most teams don't have. I mean, the nature of the position, you're going to block a shot, you're going to bruise, you're going to break a bone, whatever it might be. So to have the same six guys. Also part of the reason they didn't really go out and they got Troy Stetcher. They didn't go get a significant impact defenseman because they like the cohesiveness of a group that has played together all year long.
All right. Well, as for Sidney Crosby and company, just a painful reminder once again of where they are at right now in the standings. Jake Guentzel no longer there. We know instead he is now the newest member of the Carolina Hurricanes. Not quite ready to join the lineup, although he
get
is
him
eligible.
In the lineup. Get him on the ice. Come on.
As of Sunday to come off LTIR, and they caught up with the newest member of the Hurricanes during the game. Check it out.
Well, they've been there in the past. They've been right around it. So I think everyone's main goal is to win the Stanley Cup. And when you look up and down the lineup, I think this is a team that has the potential to do that. So we'll hopefully finish the season strong here and see what happens.
He'll lose that handle without Martin. We'll drop this back. Tee it up for Aho. Back to Martin. They score! That was masterful. Carolina jumps out to a 1-0 lead.
This was one professional pump fake by Carolina's all-star, Sebastian Aho. Martinuk knows, I want to get it to my star. Knowing the shot is going to get blocked, Martinuk didn't become a spectator, took a route that he could get himself in an offside shooting position and buries it quickly before Vladar can get over.
Position to get over the hump.
Now here's a chance for Svechnikov. He comes in. Vladar with the save. Rebound. Svechnikov side of the net. Shot by Aho. Once, twice, and Vladar with three big saves to keep this a one-goal game between Carolina and Kuznetsov. Svechnikov could get the shot through, but back to the rebound out front. Side of the net, Kuznetsov, trickles across the goal line. This building would have gone crazy.
Orlov in particular, I like that he's established his shot.
Now Aho, he'll get it right back. He puts a shot, he'll score!
Scores to complement his dazzling assist earlier in the period.
Penalty killers do the job, and now Stahl leaves it right there for Jarvis. Jarvis into the Calgary zone. And he'll shoot and score! Sheffield teed it up and hammered it past Vladar. 17 seconds into the second, 3-0 Carolina.
Maximizing the impact of a guy coming out of the box and making the right play. Stahl out of the box, puts it into an area where he can gain entry with speed. Seth Jarvis utilizes the defense. Chatfield gets it to the net.
Sixth of the season. South Carolina. Svechnikov. Aho. Svechnikov scores! It's a clinic from Carolina. 4-0 Hurricanes.
Well, we're only 21 minutes and 15 seconds in this game. We're being treated to a dominating performance. Aho gets his third point of the evening. Going back to Svechnikov. And Svechnikov buries it.
Mangiapane. Get to the bucket, he'll knock his off for Shillington. Shillington with some speed, set across and they'll score! A beautiful setup, and hammering that is Dryden Hunt, his third of the season. Set up by Oliver Shillington, and now Calgary on the board. It's 4-1 Carolina.
Beautiful feed, Slavin tries to intercept it with that deceptive stick. Hunt wastes no time, no chance for Anderson.
Back from the goal scorer, set this one out front, another chance, and Anderson makes the save on Backlund! Oh, Mr. Anderson! Going to be in the highlights tonight.
What a paddle save.
Oh no, Anderson gives it away and they'll score. Sharon Govich gets to it. Oh, the one loose play by Frederick Anderson here today, and it ends up in the back of the net. Sharon Govich makes it a 6-2 game with 15:06 left here in the third. On the playground, dribbling through everyone. And it off Kotkaniemi.
That was a good emotions when they cheer for me. You know, it's one of those that gives you extra energy, and you know, this building actually not that bad when you play another side, and you know, it's a fun place, and you know, it was a big game for us, for them, so it was a fun atmosphere, and my wife with the kids here, so I gotta talk to them if they like it or not, but I feel like they enjoyed the game. I felt like so far we've been moving the puck pretty well, and you know, that's how it is. That's how it's supposed to be. Hockey's supposed to be fun.
Well, history was made on Sunday in Carolina as Jacob Slavin's assist on Brent Burns' goal made him the franchise's all-time leading scorer among defensemen. Slavin passed former teammate Justin Falk for that milestone, which also includes blue liners from the Hartford Whalers days, so congrats to Slavin. And in this game, let's just say Calgary was under pressure, right? Yeah. Don't make me sing the song, but they were under pressure.
We'll hold off the Queen for a minute, but just absolutely. And this is what Carolina does so well. You know, Carolina's very good at defense. You know, they're very good at, you know, limiting chances and goals against. But the way they do that was a bit unique, is that they pressure not just in their own end. They pressure everywhere. It's all up the ice. It starts below the other team's goal line. And right from puck drop, it was a forecheck, and it was stifling, and Calgary had no time, no space to make a play, and you end up playing in your own end the entire game. This is what Carolina can do, and this is what makes them so hard to play against. It's miserable. Rod Brind'Amour wants to play fast, hard, in your face, but what makes them different is that they start their checking like 100 feet further up the ice. They don't wait to the red line and then get in an angle and dump it and go get it. No, we want to pressure the second you get it. Even if it's below your own goal line, and they go. And when it works well, it looks like it looked against. The shots were 15-0 in the first period at one point, 18-2 at the end of the first. It was so lopsided because that's the best version of Carolina.
Yes.
Pressure everywhere. no fun to play against.
Yeah, they can just smother you and stifle you. That's exactly what they did in this one. So poor Calgary, right? Mm-hmm. On the flip side, too, they were really good offensively, the Carolina Hurricanes. And that's still without Jake Ensel on the ice in the lineup yet. How about Evgeny Kuznetsov? We just heard from him there. He seems like he really feels like he has a new lease on life.
Well, I imagine he, when his time away, probably had some time to reflect and realize maybe how much he loves hockey and wants to play and wants to be successful. And I think he's going to be a really nice fit at a pretty good price for him and a player of his caliber. But he just rounds out a group of forwards that's already pretty good. And, oh, yeah, Jake Guentzel, when he gets in the lineup, he'll be part of that group that is dynamic. But they all play the same way. There's no Aho's line's good, so they can play one way, and Stahl's line's checks with it. They all play the same. Starts with the pressure, but then it starts with speed and getting to the net. Pretty simple offensive fundamentals, but they all do it, and they all have so many talented players up front now. Teravainen being healthy is different. Mm-hmm. And Svechnikov being healthy is different. Guentzel, Kuznetsov, you bring Burns and Slavin in the back end. All of a sudden, a team that, when they get to the playoffs, have had a hard time scoring, don't feel like they'll have quite as difficult a time scoring. And if Freddie Anderson can stay healthy and give him good goaltending, they're going to be a handful in the playoffs.
Yeah, they are. And we've said it, even going back into last offseason, look out for Carolina. Mm-hmm. Then now they've had probably the sleepiest success story over the past few months. Like, nobody's been talking about the Hurricanes.
Would not surprise me if they win the Metro when it's all said and done.
Exactly. I was going to say, New York Rangers, take warning, mm-hmm. if you will. That's the Canes' little slogan. We shall see how it all shakes out. Coming up, the Wild pulled their goalie in overtime.
What?
A very risky strategy. Did you know that if you do that and lose, you do not get the loser point? Stick around to see if that bold strategy paid off, Cotton. Is the hottest team in the league right now? It's the Nashville Predators.
It sounded like they were open for business all year, but when they're playing like this, you can't help but reward them.
Score! Cody Glass! It's hat-trick time!
It's the Roman Yossis. It's the Forsbergs. They are really leading by example.
Yossi, stop! What a goal!
They're scorching right now.
Nashville's been ridiculous.
10-0-1 in the last 11 games.
They sure look like a team determined to make the playoffs.
Who saw this coming?
The Predators are one of the best stories that we've seen throughout this NHL season. Nobody expected them to make the playoffs coming into the season. A month ago, no one expected them to maybe even keep Juuse Saros. We thought for sure the Preds would be sellers at the deadline. Instead, the way the team has played, they have forced the hand of Barry Trotz and company to not only not sell Saros, but add a couple of key, nice depth pieces at the deadline. And this is exactly what they've done. You see how far they've come in terms of making up ground in the wild card standings? That's because they've gone 10-0-1 entering Sunday in their last 11 games. Johnny, how do you explain what we've seen?
So they went from 4 out to almost 10 in. I mean, they go on the run. Juuse Saros, not going to get traded because he's playing so well. They've committed to defense and have been so much better defensively. And everybody's scoring, which makes it much easier. Led by Roman Yossi for sure. But I think just the entire game has come together at the exact right time. But it has started with better defense, better structure, and better goaltending, whether it's been Lankinen, but specifically Saros. And they just keep finding ways to win games, tight games, and pick up points. And all of a sudden now it's no longer, will they make the playoffs? More like, where are they going to finish when they make the playoffs?
Yeah, that's when the 11-game point streak will do. And guess what? Spoiler alert, that point streak continued on Sunday in a Central Division showdown against Minnesota. But you will definitely want to stick around for this full highlight because things got crazy late.
These are two teams that had a couple nasty meetings in the last few. There's Tommy Novak on the back. And great save by Fleury. Point blank on the redirect from Mark Jankowski.
Here we go.
Marcus Foligno dropping the gloves with Michael McCarron. Oh, Foligno got him against the boards. Look out here. Foligno with the upper hand. They're letting them fly. We knew this was coming.
Oh, and this place is jumping. Holy jumping. This is great stuff.
Eriksson Ek moves in. Stick breaks out of the hands of Lauzon. Centering pass. Brodin save. Soros rebound save. Scramble in the blue paint. Puck still free. They score! Zuccarello dancing his way in across. Oh, Saros got across in time. Puck back to goal and he covers up. How did that not go in?
Both these goaltenders can put on an exhibition when it comes from post to post, like butter on toast.
Chopped at by Sherwood. Kaprizov, turn it over, centering, they score! Jankowski has tied it.
This line not only getting under the skin of the Minnesota Wild with Sherwood and some of the things early on, but here's the steal. Smith goes in there. He puts pressure. First man in, second man gets the puck. The third man's up high in a goal-scoring position, and boy, does Jankowski ever fire this one high. And here we go, another scrap right here.
Right along the boards, it's Sherwood.
Not surprised there.
And Shaw.
Sherwood battling back right here. This is a good scrap.
Intercepted. Here comes Kaprizov on a breakaway. Kaprizov moving in. Save by Soros.
Up here, Jankowski to turn the corner. Puck knocked off his stick. Gets it back. Jankowski shot. Block. Loose puck. They score!
What a fortuitous bounce. And Evangelista buries it.
Boy, I thought by that thud that Fleury got his right pad on it. Well, that was the thud of the puck hitting the back of the net.
Whips it back behind McCarron out in front. Oh, Fleury got across to deny Sherwood. Rewind that one and hang on to it.
And an open ice hit that results in a penalty.
Oh, he leans into him. Yeah, he sure does.
Zuccarello, shot, save, rebound, save. Third save by Soros. Puck available in the blue paint. And it's in. Power play goal for the Wild. And this game is tied.
On a game that's been defined by physical play, no surprise. There's a greasy one at the net front. Here comes Evangelista on a breakaway. Evangelista deeks. Oh, Fleury came out to cut him down.
What a play that was. I mean, Fleury looked like he kind of tripped him up right there on that play. Never gives up, that guy. Never gives up.
Stand up by Carrier, denying the entry.
Beauvillier, rip wide, put on a platter. Hartman to give Minnesota the lead. Scores!
Hartman read that pass the entire way. And give Hartman a lot of credit here after he picks it off in the middle of the ice. He's in all alone, but it's the patience on the back end. He doesn't just shovel it right away. He waits for Soros to go down. That's a brilliant play there by Hartman. Predators will get an opportunity to tie the game up.
Yossi cradles. There goes Soros to the bench.
Shot, score! Ryan O'Reilly has tied the game.
I mean, this is just a beautiful wrist shot. Fleury's got no chance at all.
6 seconds. Play to the middle. Sissons able to get to it. A late stick lift. And that takes us to the end of regulation time. Kaprizov still lingering with the puck, and Fleury to the bench.
How about this move here?
Wow.
I mean,
they need every point, Banger.
Yeah, they do.
Empty net for Minnesota in a 3-3 game in overtime. How about this move from John Hines to get four attackers out there? Zuccarello from the circle. Boulding scores!
Oh my.
What a move by John Hines to pull the goaltender. And the Wild win it in overtime.
We need 2 points. And, you know, we feel like we were organized with it. The players knew what was going on, and I think it's when you put the four guys we have on the ice that we believe that, you know, it gives us the best chance to score a goal and get 2 points, and that's what we're here for. It's not something that you do, you know, all the time, but I think in our position, 1 point, no point, it's not going to do us any good. We got to get 2 points.
I'm not sure if you know the rule, but Nashville scores, you lose the point in the standings. Did you know that?
Oh, no, I did not know that. Good thing we scored. Yeah.
Have you ever been pulled in?
No, T. I don't know, honestly. I don't know that for breakfast, so it's tough to remember all these years, right? But I'll remember this one, though. I think it was such a great feeling, great ending to the game here.
What a moment. So here is rule 84.2 about pulling your goalie in overtime.
This one's for Matt Boldy.
Yes. And me, honestly, before going into tonight. This is crazy. Ultimately, if you do so, when it's not during a delayed penalty and the other team scores, the losing team forfeits the point that they got for reaching overtime. So, Johnny, you know, we've talked a lot about this off camera, but why do you think this was beneficial? Why did Hines decide to do this?
Okay, so it's a lot to unpack, but I love it because this kind of strategy doesn't always come into play in the NHL because it's such a fluid sport. You don't really have time to make these kind of decisions. So what Nashville and Minnesota is taking into consideration. So Minnesota's, okay, we're behind. We basically can lose 4 games the rest of the season. 8 points we can afford to lose.
Mm-hmm.
So he'd be taking into consideration, what is our record in a shootout? And they're around 500. What's Nashville's record in a shootout?
Mm.
They're perfect. They haven't lost a point yet.
Okay.
What are we like when we're 4-on-3? Well, they now have scored 2 goals in 41 seconds of 4-on-3 time.
Right, true.
So they're pretty good. Now, strategy-wise, you're going to do it, obviously, late in the overtime. Give yourself about a minute, which they did. So if you don't score, the time runs out and you go to a shootout. You want to do it with your best players rested when you can to give them a chance. Now, I would also like my best players to know that if we give up the empty net or we lose the point we got going for, he said he did not know about, because as a player on the ice, I would want to know not to make high-risk plays trying to score a goal and risk an empty netter against.
Yeah.
Even to the point where I'd rather just let the time run out,
yeah,
make sure we get a point as opposed to make a risky play that could come back and hurt us in our own end. But either way, brilliant strategy and appropriate the timing, because it has to be sort of desperation time for this,
yeah,
to work. And it is desperation time.
When you mean look in at the season.
In
yes,
the season
yes.
for Minnesota, and look at the standings and what they need to do, the 8 points that I think they can probably lose to have a chance. And so they did it. Fleury was creeping out. He's creeping out. He went, and I could see, once he got to the top of circles, I knew what they were doing.
Oh, man.
And the fact that it turned out perfectly was very exciting, but something we have not seen very often.
No.
It's been years since seeing a goalie pulled in a 3-on-3 overtime.
And I guess we did see it in 2017.
Yeah.
It happened. But again, if Nashville had scored in the empty net, yeah, Minnesota would have forfeited the point. That did not happen. Obviously, Minnesota gets two. Nashville does still get one.
This one happened. There was 4 seconds left in the overtime.
Okay.
Remember,
time
to fully, maybe 2 seconds.
That's right.
And to fully score.
Yes.
Yes. But that was different because that was just for the shootout, for the face-off.
Yeah,
and the time
different.
Was going to expire.
Yes.
It was different in the sense that this was, we're accepting the risk.
Yeah.
We
for
know
a full minute
for
plus.
A minute 20, if they give up the empty net goal, Minnesota's going to lose the point that they earned.
Yeah.
But we want the two. And I guess what you're giving yourself is two cracks at it. You're giving yourself the chance at a 4-on-3
yep.
to get the second point. And if it doesn't work, and hopefully you don't give up the empty netter, you mm-hmm. give yourself a chance to get the extra point in a shootout.
Yeah.
So you give yourself two chances to get that extra point. But it also speaks, and I love it. I love the spirit behind the decision is, I don't care about the extra point.
Yeah.
I only care about winning because we're charging for a playoff spot. We're not worried about the downside. We're focusing on the upside. I love what
yeah.
the message and the energy that gives the group, because now Minnesota, they have 17 games left, right? So if you want to get to 95 points, 13-4 gets you to 95 points.
Uh-huh.
And given how good the teams are above them, you got to think Vegas is going to, 95 points still might not be enough.
Right.
So that's why you do it.
Mm-hmm.
Situation critical. You need every single point. Brilliant stuff. But it's amazing. Even the guys on the ice, us, did not know the rule.
Yeah, kind of.
But they'll know it now, and everyone around the league will know
right.
it now.
I also love the fact too that you can't let the other team can't ice or will ice the puck, right? They can't just clear it like a power play
right.
or something like that. That factors
but
into this as
let
well.
Let me tell you, if I'm on Nashville, I get the puck on my stick, I'm taking a shot at the empty net
right.
every
right.
single time.
Right. Well,
take the icing. Who cares?
Very interesting. Okay, take a look at the next four games for Minnesota. They play teams outside
okay.
of playoff position in 6 of their next 7.
It's going to run.
So they could very much make things interesting. We shall see. This Minnesota girl, cautiously optimistic.
They're going streaking through the quad.
We'll see. I love it. Connor Bedard had a career-high 8-game gold drought coming into Sunday's tilt with the Oats. He put that to bed with not one, but 2 goals. We've got highlights next. Welcome back to On the Fly. Let's check out the Islanders in Anaheim.
Get into a playoff spot with a win here tonight.
Just get it in there and get your wheels going.
Terry sends it to the back post. This is touched towards Varlamov. He's going to seal it with the right pad.
I don't think that went in, did it?
And this is coming from Toronto. This is not a coach's challenge. And so we're still scoreless. That's a little careless, though, in their own zone. Good hard work down low for Holmstrom. Pulls it free, and they score! Casey Cizikas out front, but all the work done by Simon Holmstrom to set it up. The Islanders are off and running.
I was saying, when the Islanders aren't a one-line pony, are they? No. He digs the puck out, and Casey gets rid of it as quickly as he can.
It's like they are waiting for a young team like the Ducks to make a mistake.
Long lead pass here to Palmieri. He's in the clear. Backhand shot on the goal line. He scores.
What a pass this is out of the zone by Riley.
Ducks were pushing everybody up offensively, trying to tie the game, and the Islanders make him pay as Palmieri gets in behind the defense. He's got another one against his former team. Kyle Palmieri red hot.
Islanders off to a good start, and power play would be huge.
Critical moment in this game.
Goal shy of the 30-goal mark yet again. Horvat to Nelson. He scores!
It's a power play goal. It's a 3-0 lead, and Brock Nelson nets his 29th of the season to match his number.
He just dips it right up in the toy department, and Christmas is coming early this year. The boys are really finding that.
20 minutes in the books, the Islanders with a 3-0 lead.
The Ducks just struggle early in games, and we've seen it again here this afternoon.
Off to the races, Max Jones. He's got a trailer. Killorn pulls it in and scores! Alex Killorn with a goal in his fourth consecutive game.
Well, that's the start that the Ducks were looking for in this period, and that gets the crowd engaged. The Ducks have some life.
Dobson handles. One-timer from Horvat, gloved off by Dostal.
There's their first shot of the second period. It's a good stop.
Here's Ben Myers. Myers across the line. In front for Zellweger, low backhander, and Varlamov cuts that off and covers.
It was a real nice play by Ben Myers.
So Anaheim has cut it to a two-goal deficit. We're through 40 minutes of play. Horvat wins the draw at the other end, and the Islanders go to work. Nelson gets it in front, and that's easy for Bo Horvat.
Just 34 seconds into the period. A quick one for the Islanders, and it's 4-1.
And that's what they needed. I don't think that was necessarily was a pass by Brock Nelson, but Bo said, I got that.
Gudas awaiting this one, but it won't arrive. Stolen away, Engvall. He's quick. He's in alone, and he scores! Pierre Engvall with a burst of speed, and the Islanders lead 5-1.
Interception by Engvall, and then his eyes are as big as saucers, and turns it on.
Eighth of the season for Engvall.
The Islanders continue their role, winning for the sixth straight game. New York has outscored its opponents 30-11 in that span. And how about this? It was Semyon Varlamov's first win in nearly 3 months. His last victory came December 13th, also against the Anaheim Ducks. So I guess, you know, one way to just get back on track. He played Anaheim.
When do they play the Ducks again?
Yeah. Oh,
not till next year.
Not till next year. But congrats, Isles fans. Not sure if you knew this day was going to come yet the rest of this season, but they are back in a playoff spot with a huge 2 points. It's the first time the Isles are in a playoff spot since January 13th, nearly two full months. What have you made of their run lately, Johnny?
I mean, six games, 30 goals. That's a lot of offense out of the Islanders. But there is something so symbolically important for the Islanders right now that they have tied Detroit. They have one more game in hand. So by points percentage, they are in the playoffs with 5 weeks left.
Wow.
And there's been part of the adjustment, Patrick Waugh coming in. They got to get used to him and his system and the way he wants to play, but also personality-wise. They got to get everyone healthy and rolling. But I guess this is the part that teams get worried about for the New York Islanders, because when they do get going, they have great goaltending, two of them now that Varlamov's back and healthy and maybe playing better, and they have a whole bunch of veteran players that can play really well in a tight system, be defensive, and they don't have to rely on any one superstar, other than maybe Sorokin, but it really is a cumulative team effort, and that could be a dangerous thing rolling down the stretch. I knew those two teams in Atlanta were going to be like the Tampa and Detroit were not safe, not home and cooled at all. And I think for Detroit or for the Islanders, they've got in, they've gotten above the bar. Now it's about staying above the bar, pushing that team further down past you. So really significant game, and they've got a nice little run to get there. And we'll see, they got to keep it going now, but that is huge for the Islanders.
And they are a really good team. I mean, if you look again at the standings, you can see that they have way more overtime shootout losses than any other team. So if you think that they would have won half of those games that ended up being 1 point instead of two, they would be much more securely in a playoff spot. So maybe this whole time we should have thought of them as a playoff team, because they've shown they have the talent to be.
Yeah, the margins that they play in are probably better than the place in the standings.
Yeah.
But the good news is, when you get to the playoffs, if you get there, guess what? There's no shootouts.
No
3-on-3. They play 5-on-5 until somebody wins. So they're in a good spot.
Very interesting. Let's continue with the highlights with Chicago hosting Arizona.
Now let's see what they can do here in a 4-on-4. Keller trying to get to the middle, and now Nick Schmaltz with it. And they'll go back out high. Keller with a shot. He scores. Clayton Keller. Early lead. And it's 1-0 Coyotes.
Clayton Keller at it again. And that is a big-time goal
just rolling.
Up to Kesselring. We're inside of a minute to go in the first period, and Vlasic has just dropped the gloves with Nick Bjugstad. Vlasic, not a fighter. Bjugstad, a couple of glove taps on Vlasic, who takes him down.
That's two big fellas trading hands.
It's just a battle for a loose puck down low, but that's two great big boys and really competitive.
Clayton Keller, the first period goal, the only one so far.
Chance and fraud, and Keller early on has made it 2-0.
What a move. Clayton Keller, are you kidding me? That's how you start this second period off. Just a quick little snapper.
Deep Bedard for Reese Johnson in front. Score! A greasy puck slips past Ingram, and the Hawks are on the board.
Connor just kind of puts that back into traffic. Smart play by Connor.
Vlasic shoots. Loose in front. Blackwell scores! We are tied!
Blackwell himself just knocks that down and takes advantage of a Connor Ingram, who's kind of sprawling to collect that puck. Beautiful play.
Hawks will have a 5-on-3 for Bedard. He drags, shoots, scores! Put him away, Connor Bedard. It's 3-2.
That's just flat out fun to watch. Very cold, very calculated, very methodical, and just rifles it past Connor Ingram.
A Soderstrom over the top of the net. Bouncing puck, and they score, and they get it on the rush. And guess who? Dylan Gunther right in front, and the game is tied.
That's a big goal to tie this one up and get that momentum back from the Hawks, who have come with a real big push.
Power play for the Hawks. Backdoor feed, Johnson scores! Blackhawks grab the lead on the power play.
Connor, beautiful pass, goes back across his body to find Johnson on the far side. That's just an all-business power play.
Dickinson feeds Jones. Backhanded into the crease. Blackwell's got another one. He scores, and the Hawks go up 5-3.
Jason Dickinson is having himself a massive night. Big goal, insurance marker for the Hawks.
They're going right now, down low, a chance in front, Valimaki. And now another shot, stop, Sutter, and a rebound is put home, and that's Nick Schmaltz to make it a one-goal game.
Soderblom with a couple of five alarm stops.
Coyotes just peppering the Hawks on their heels. This is where you want to play if you're a Coyote fan.
Fortunato, who plays it to himself. He shoots, and he scores! What a rocket from Ryan Donato!
There he goes in puck support. Little chip to himself. And how about that shot up and over the right shoulder of Ingram?
Seth Jones past Gunther. Moser tees up. Keller, what a stop by Soderblom. Keller again missed the net.
Great read and react. He sees it transition from his right to his left. That's just a beautiful save by Soderblom.
Colin Blackwell jumps on it. Blackwell to the empty net. It's a hat trick for Colin Blackwell.
Big moment and good for Colin. Just no shortage of heroes in this one. Puck is kind of chipped out into neutral ice. Blackwell's able to track it down. A lot of fun to watch, and he has done yeoman service for this group here tonight. That's a big moment for Colin.
It's Colin Blackwell with the Hat Trick Challenge presented by AstraZeneca. The Blackhawks got 7 goals on Sunday, which represented the most they've scored all season. And Chicago has only scored that many goals on 4 occasions over the past 3 seasons. Coming up, Sunday is Oscar night, and so we thought we'd give out our own awards. Stick around to hear our best director, best picture, and best actors across the NHL.
Welcome to Nashville and the 2023 NHL Awards. Tonight we're recognizing the outstanding accomplishments from a fantastic year of hockey.
The Vezina Trophy goes to Linus Ullmark.
James Morris Memorial Trophy goes to Eric Carlson.
Now to present the biggest award of the night.
And the winner of the Hart Memorial Trophy is Connor McDavid.
To my teammates, I truly would not be standing up here if it wasn't for each and every single one of you guys. Thank you.
Oh, yes. Well, we have to wait a few more months till this year's NHL Awards, but we have the On the Fly Awards. Wow, they made us look really good stuff. We're not quite there.
We look exactly the same.
Exactly. It is the Oscars on this Sunday evening, mm-hmm. and so we thought we'd have our On the Fly Awards in honor of the biggest night in Hollywood. And so with that, we're doing a bit of a Hollywood theme. So stick with us, if you will. Mm-hmm. Let's start with Best Actor in a Leading Role, a.k.a. Mm-hmm. probably Hart Trophy. Mm-hmm. Who is your MVP? Best Actor in a Leading Role goes to...
Let's check the envelope. It goes to... Nathan MacKinnon is the winner of the Best Actor. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it feels like it has to be Nathan MacKinnon at this point, given what he's done for the Colorado Avalanche, how consistent he's been. Obviously, the home point streak is bordering on historical. Him and Wayne Gretzky sort of company. Remember, it hasn't always been a full complement of players. The supporting cast around Nathan MacKinnon hasn't always been full. It's been a lot of injuries and situations that have had him play sometimes on a thinner lineup. And he is just a man possessed the way he plays. The goals, the assists, the points, and he has his team, once again, challenging for first place in the Central. He's been as good as he's ever played, and that's saying something.
Yes. No, I would have to agree with you. He would be the best actor in a leading role. But there's another category. Best actor in a supporting role. Who do you have?
And this is maybe my favorite because Sam Reinhart in a supporting role. Because if you think about the Florida Panthers, where would Sam Reinhart be in the top players in Florida? Sixth?
Wow.
You have Barkov and Kachuk and Verhage and Montour and Ekblad and Bob. I mean, you go down the list a couple notches. Forsling, who knows before you get to Reinhart. And yet here he is in a contract year, which makes me happy. He's going to break the box office with his next contract.
Nice.
Because he's on pace to score in the mid-50s,
wow.
upper 50s goals. He's already well past his career high.
Mm-hmm.
He's
going to
push 100 points. He also plays a ton on the penalty kill, which you might not think of Sam Reinhart as a defensive player or maybe even a speedy player, but he does it all. Shorthanded goals, power play goals. He's got the league in that. He has had an incredible season. Timing could not be better for Sam Reinhart, but he's still on Florida, a supporting character.
Yeah, okay. I like it. All right, continuing the movie theme, we know that a good movie is only as good as its editor.
Okay.
And so, you know, you could probably say the same thing about a hockey team.
Mm-hmm.
So who is the best editor, general manager, mm-hmm. builder, changer of the team? Who gets the Oscar in this case?
The Oscar goes to Kelly McCrimmon,
ooh.
Vegas Golden Knights. Because I like a movie with a twist.
Ha.
I don't like to know what's going to happen. We just saw him do. Now, we know Vegas goes after top players. But pulling off Tomáš Hertl when I or anybody in hockey had not heard a peep that he wasn't even involved in this movie.
Right.
We thought he was already on a different cast somewhere down in San Jose. He was injured. He was coming off a knee surgery. Nobody had any idea. And yet there goes Kelly McCrimmon, just slides on in there, picks him up. I like Mantha. Of course, I like Noah Hanifin. They're very, very good players. They're almost predictable. But it was the twist at the end, right at 3 p.m. on trade deadline day, that he pulled off getting Hurdle out of San Jose. No idea. And once again, Vegas loading up for another attempt at winning the Stanley Cup.
Yep.
And Hurdle is healthy and right. He'll be a big part of any success they have.
And we still can't wait to see how this movie ends because there might be another twist or
They're
two.
They're looking for a sequel
no
of
way.
Last year's.
Oh,
okay.
The puns just keep coming. Okay, one more, a couple more for you. Best director, a.k.a. coach.
All right, so I'm going to be a little biased because I voted for this one and I gave it to Rick Bowness, one of my favorite people in the league. What he's done in Winnipeg with his staff, because he did miss some time early in the year, has been amazing. Because you think about where Winnipeg was last summer, or even at the end of last year, where he was not pleased with the team, the way that they finished the season. We thought that Scheifele was going to leave, and Hellebuck was going to leave, and the captain Wheeler was going to leave, and he's brought them back, and he's got them playing together, cohesive, physical, defensive hockey. The kind of game that Rick Bowness wants his teams to play. And I like him because he's a hard director to play for. Even though they're having a great season, he's hard on them. He's hard on them in public.
Yep.
After the game on Saturday night against Vancouver, he said, that's the worst we've played all year. This is a team that's challenging for first
right.
in the league, and yet he's not afraid to call out his best players or his team if he doesn't like it. He's done a masterful job, and I am delighted to see him having the success he's having. Now he just has to follow that up in the playoffs.
Okay, great. So, last but not least, the best picture goes to, and that's all right, let's give context. Best picture, we already know more things have to play out.
Right.
But to this point in the season, mm-hmm. what has been the best storyline, the best picture?
Sometimes things happen in sports that you can't even script in a movie.
Mm.
And this one, Patrick Kane's return to Chicago. How could this not be? Yes. Patty, well done. You worked it out perfectly. This was such a great night for hockey. And it's Chris Chelios getting honored in Chicago. He played for Detroit. He played for the Blackhawks. Patrick Kane, who will have his number up in the rafters in Chicago someday. He comes back for the first time. And, yeah, come on, give it to me.
Let's go.
We want some more showtime for Patrick Kane. Game gets to overtime. He gets a breakaway. He's got all kinds of time. He even checks. No one's chasing me. It's just me and the goaltender. And, of course, he ends it with a goal and a celebration.
In OT.
Talking to the fans, they gave it to him for 15 years, giving it right back all the affection and the admiration that he deserves. I mean, you couldn't script that kind of finish. It was perfect, and Patrick Kane pulled it off beautifully.
And you're right, they got a standing ovation. They gave it to him despite the fact that their team, the Blackhawks, lost. They didn't care.
The big winner that night was Patrick Kane.
Yes, indeed. Okay, well, thanks so much for playing along with us here on Oscar night. We'll see what the drama has yet to unfold the rest of the season. And that brings us now to your top shelf plays of the night.
Give it away. Foligno behind the back. Oh, what a save by Soros, denying the rookie Adam Beckman.
He actually put it on the right-handed Forsberg's tape. Beckman right in the goal scorer's position.
And they'll go back out high. Keller with a shot, he scores! Clayton Keller!
Clayton Keller at it again. Just rolling.
They drop this back. Teed up for Aho, back to Martin, they score! That was masterful! Carolina jumps out to a 1-0 lead.
This was one professional pump thing.
Here is Jeff Bedard. He drags, shoots, scores!
He waits for Saros to go down, and most goalies do. Their balance will take them on their bellies right there, down low, wait a little bit, instead of stuffing it into them or going to the five hole. That's a brilliant play there by Hartman.
Welcome back to On the Fly. News out of Philly is that head coach John Tortorella has been suspended for 2 games and fined $50,000. We know all about the antics that went on where he, for a while, refused to leave the bench and was eventually kicked off of the bench. And a horrific loss for his team. What do you make of the decision? 2 games.
Well, I mean, I think the referees in the league give players and coaches a lot of leeway. I'm down between the benches. I hear the language. Yeah. I know what's said. And a lot can be said before you get kicked out, before you get a penalty. And certainly once you're kicked out, you have to leave. And John Tortorella knows this. Now, what the refs hate the most is when it becomes a spectacle. You know, if it's between you and the ref, and they may not hear nice words, but it doesn't matter if nobody else knows. But when you make a big scene like that, that's when the league and the officials don't appreciate it. I only say this. 2 things can happen here. One, this is a bad look about controlling your temper and your discipline that John Tortorella requires from his players.
Yeah.
So you're going to ask the players to be disciplined and under control? You have to be. But on the flip side, can it be a rallying force? Let's do it us against the world, and maybe even without John Tortorella, who can prepare them, even though he's not on the bench, it shouldn't be that much tactically different during the game.
Yeah.
Could go the other way and kind of motivate them, galvanize them, us against the world sort of thing. So we'll see how it goes. But not a great time of the year with Philly struggling, trying to hold on to a playoff spot, to not have your head coach available.
Yeah, not a good time at all. We'll see if Philly can withstand being without Torts for the next couple games. It's time for your 3 stars from Sunday. Our 3rd star goes to Connor McDavid, who had 3 points in a win over the Penguins. McDavid now has 17 points in his last 6 meetings with Pittsburgh. Our 2nd star goes to Chicago's Connor Bedard, who snapped an 8-game goal drought with a pair of tallies in a 7-4 win over the Coyotes. Bedard now has 19 goals on the campaign. And your 1st star from Sunday goes to John Hines and the Wild coaching staff for their decision to pull Marc-Andre Fleury in overtime. The Wild scored shortly after that and got the 2 points. Maybe, just maybe, are hanging on to hope they will make the Stanley Cup playoffs.
What a gutsy decision.
What a gutsy decision.
Catching everyone off guard, and it worked perfectly, just the way the coach draws it up.
I don't think we've ever had a coach be the 1st star of the night in my time.
First and last
9 years of On the Fly. Congrats, Heinze. That'll do it for us here on the Fly. For Mike Johnson, I'm Jamie Hirsch. Here now is the best from Sunday.
Might be daylight savings, could be daylight scoring.
A turnover. Red shot score. Connor McDavid.
Moving and good for Collins.
Look out here. They're letting them fly.
This place is jumping.
Put them away. Connor Bedard.
Back to Martin. They score.
That was masterful.
Empty net for Minnesota.